just when we talk about movement, like when we say some words like chané, like pirouette, arabesque, like foite, all this movement, we take it from ballet. So we should to know how this technique to make the style is much better.
Welcome to Ballet Dance Live podcast with weekly portion of stories, tips and dance inspiration. My name is Iana Komarnytska, I'm your host and I invite you to explore all nuances of Ballet Dance Live together with me and our amazing guests. Let's start. Hello everyone, welcome to podcast, to Ballet Dance Live podcast. I'm very happy to you are tuning in right now, and hopefully you are nailing your dance performances and your dance training sessions. Anyway, my lozenge of this week is, if it doesn't exist, create it. This is exactly how this podcast came to life, that I really wanted to hear from other dancers, like their stories and insights on all sorts of different topics, and I wasn't able to find something that would fit specifically me and what I was really envisioning it to look like, so I created it like this. Another funny problem that last year I tried to solve, sort of for myself, but not really just for myself, is, you know, this situation that you have a ballet dance friend and their birthday is coming up and you don't really know what to get as a gift. That was my pain point for many years, and I was always thinking like, okay, costume, it's too expensive, I can't afford just to give as a present or gift to someone's birthday a costume. Then a hip scarf, yeah, but it's too typical, only if I find something like really, really, really cute. But it's very difficult, especially back a few years ago, to find some really unusual cool hip scarves unless you travel from festival to festival. And then another option, what was like jewelries. Okay, that's useful, that's always pretty, it's always cool. But it's sort of like again and again the same idea, like there is nothing like to be surprised about jewelry. It's like, yes, we all love as ballet dancers pretty things and jewelry to complement our costumes or our day-to-day looks, but I mean, you sometimes just want to get something cute, not too expensive, but something that will surprise your friend and will be related to ballet dance, because this is the thing that unites you and your friend, and you want to acknowledge that you also share the love to this art, and you acknowledge their interest. And we always want, if we are talking about ballet dance friends, we always want to give them some gifts that are related to this art form. Oh, in most cases, this is one of the options, like something related to dance. And it's super difficult to find something that would be cute, affordable, and like not typical as like jewelry or, I don't know, hip scarf or something like that. So that's how my idea of minor dancer came on. So originally, it was just a story with, okay, I want something that would be cute and related to ballet dance. That's why most of the items in that store is, they're not typical ballet dance items. It's usually some life accessories like mugs and notebooks and phone cases, but everything inspired with ballet dance designs. Because my original idea was, I just want to solve this problem even for myself and have some cute options and stuff to give as a gift to friends. But of course, we decided to add a couple of actual outfits, training outfits, because it was logical. Okay, this is also logical to be fit in the ballet dance online store. But how big my surprise right now to discover that our best-selling thing is actually a hoodie with a ballet dance design on it. That honestly was really my surprise, that people will love it so much and this will be our top-selling thing, because it's not directly a training form. I mean, In the cold winter days, of course, we start training with multi layers on us and then we take them off. But it's something that actually, in most cases, we'll wear in regular day-to-day life. But how many people actually want to have some presence of ballet dance in their daily life and routines and in re on the regular clothing? So, surprisingly, I mean, not surprisingly, but surprisingly for me, our hoodie was a great match for that. And this really made me realize once again that sometimes we create some project based on our own thoughts of own preferences and thinking, oh, if we like it, if we need it, everyone else will want to. And for sure, there will be a lot of people who will share this interest or need or just enthusiasm about this item. But in many cases, we cannot rely on just our own preferences and ideas because we do not know what other people will like or make. And the whole reason of why I am telling you about this is just because don't be afraid to put stuff out and just wait for people's reactions. So whatever it is, like I'm talking about online store, but this can relate to whatever artistic project, whatever thought for a long time I want to put it out, but I don't think people will like it or people will be into it. You know, stop this voice in your head and just put it out and wait for people's reaction because they may surprise you either way. Yes, maybe someone will not share much of interest in the exact same thing that you will, but be sure there will be people who will like it for sure. Maybe not as many as you wished, but it's just the matter of time and methods of finding and reaching them. But there for sure will be people who will like it, but there are maybe people who will surprise you with completely different perspective on your work and your project and give you some other ideas of how to expand or how even to see your own work. So forget about this annoying voice in your head that tells you to not do something, just go and do it, and don't necessarily rely on only your own judgments. Yes, you need to listen your inner voice, and this is very important to be in line with your own beliefs and your own inspirations. You need to do something that sparks us and gives us enthusiasm to go and do it from day to day. But we kind of have always two voices in our head. One is telling us, yes, I want to do it, and another tells us, don't be silly, nobody will like it, or anything like that. So, my point first, don't be afraid to actually put it out. Nothing bad will happen. The worst, like, okay, people will not notice, which I really doubt, but that's the worst case scenario. What may happen with whatever project you're working on? And second, don't be afraid to ask, but ask not only feedback from your close environment, like friends or relatives, because they may be a little bit biased too about. They will be evaluating whatever they need to talk about from their perspective of knowing you and also worrying if it's safe path or not safe path. Is it project will maybe put you a bit further from them or make you different? And this is a scary place for them too. But don't be afraid to ask a general audience. Ask people who you would like to reach with your project, whatever we are talking about, your dance videos, your articles, your, I don't know, handcrafty stuff, because we probably have a lot of talented people here who are not only doing dance, but doing some handcraft, or I don't know, maybe makeup artists, or teachers, or entrepreneurs, or whoever it is, because in many cases, we combine our ballet dance passion with whatever other activities we have in our life. So, don't be afraid to put it out and don't be afraid to ask people's feedback and people's ideas about your project because I guarantee you'll be surprised to hear. I was surprised with both my podcast and the feedback from people that I got, and I'm really grateful for everyone who reach out and tells me what they like, what they wish to hear. Don't forget, we always have a feedback form on the main page, janadance.com/podcast, that you can reach out and give your feedback and just get a chance to for me to connect back to you as a listener and to know what exactly you are searching. So again, I'm not relying only on my own preferences of what to put in this project, but also I got surprised with this idea of online store, my inner dance, and people's reaction that hoodie was their most favorite things, according at least to number of orders we received. And right away, digging in what I'm preaching here, I would love also to ask you your ideas and feedback on my inner dancer store, and to see what kind of things you are missing in ballet dance world, and maybe I will be able to find them for you and make them available. Whatever it is, either you're looking for more, I don't know, training, cute training outfits, like what kind of training outfits? Is it more diverse variety of our mug collection or anything like that, or maybe jewelers or whatever you are sort of thinking, oh, I really wish there was this thing, but there is no ballet dance store that offers it. Reach out to me, give me idea, because I may be able to find it. I'm right now currently in this mode of searching and complementing our great selection of items at My Inner Dancer with even more cute designs and cute things there. And I would be happy to hear back from you what you think is missing in the store, and what you would be interested in actually having. And the way to do it is super easy. Like, first of all, if you haven't checked My Inner Dancer, you can do it at myinnerdancer.com. I also will link it in the show notes, but the website is literally the name, myinnerdancer.com. And check, because maybe you are also looking right now for some gifts for your ballet dance friends, who knows. There you can get some very cute ideas about it. But also, simply feel free to reach me out on social media, either Instagram or Facebook. I'm Iana Komarnytska, Iana Dance. Again, all links are also in the show notes. But reach me out on social media and just drop me a quick message. Oh, I heard this podcast. You were talking about My Inner Dancer. Can you find something like that and add to the store? I really can't find it anywhere else. And let's see, maybe I will be able, and I will be really happy, because again, I was taking this, creating this project from a sort of a selfish need. I want something like this, but it's not only about me. The store doesn't exist for one person, and as well as this podcast, like, started it from my own need to hear from other dancers, to connect, to learn from their experience. But this is not just about me as a host, it's also about you as listeners. So I'm also, again, happy to hear your feedback and which dances and which topics you'd like to hear. I'm not able sometimes right away to bring them on podcast. It's a little bit complicated behind the scene process of bringing people here. So bear with me if you send some sort of requests or preferences or wishes, and I am not able to make them happen yet. But there are a lot of dancers who I connected with, and I'm just waiting the proper moment to finally sit down and record an interview, and hopefully they all will be soon here. But for today, we have amazing guest who is spreading love to Egyptian folklore and Oriental all around the world. And for those who may not know Wael Mansour, here is a quick background about him. Wael Mansour was born in Cairo, where he studied Egyptian dance and ballet at the National Academy of Folklore and Theater, and he became one of the best choreographers and solo dancers of Egyptian folklore and contemporary Oriental dance there. He used to work in a balloon theater in Cairo, but then he switched to working more with different various private groups there, and later he decided to pursue his goals and dreams by moving to Europe and spreading love to Egyptian dance and culture all around the world. He was featured in numerous TV shows, cinema, as well as festivals in Egypt and internationally. He is event organizer of several dance events, and you'll hear in this interview about several new festivals as he is about to announce soon on social media, as well as he is a producer of a number of music CDs, and one of the famous songs that you for sure heard, Mazagat, it was produced under his direction. He is sort of a creator of the song, and this you may have not known. So listen to this interview, absorb information from one of the most significant professionals of Egyptian dance in today's world. I hope you enjoy it. Again, don't forget to leave feedback and reach out both to me and to our amazing guest. And just before I let you finally dive in the interview, quick thank you to our supporters, Ballet Dance Evolution. Following Jelena's BD activities, I'm always impressed with the level of their theatrical performances as well as educational programs that serves dancers at all levels. Don't forget that applications for Jelena's BD experience in New Bern, North Carolina are still open. Also, you can now audition to join the cast for their 10th anniversary Best of BDE performance in Los Angeles. Please visit balletdanceevolution.com for more information about it. Hello, Wael. Welcome to our podcast. I'm really joyful to talk to you today. And how's it going? How was your day today?
Everything is good. Thank you. Thank you.
To start our conversation, when I was doing research, I was really surprised to find out that you actually have a Master of Science degree in engineering. But while you were living in Egypt, you also was studying Egyptian folklore and ballet at the Egyptian National School. Can you take us back in time and tell us a little bit about those years of your life and how dance came into your life into more like serious professional level?
That's what he what mean when you love the art. So in Egypt we should our families normal families you should to study, you should to finish your university, you should to finish your career. If you wanna be study art or you wanna be artist or something like this, you should to finish your study first because you should to have two of both together, okay? But only artists, not every family allowed this. So my family it pushed me to study and accept also to be study dance, but should to study finish my school, my university. So I finish with normal schools until university. So I finished study engineering. But with this, when I was young, I start to study dance in folkloric groups. And normally we have in this group, for example, like Elkawmeia, we study the basic of ballet also with the folklore. So we have basic of two of both together. And when I get to be professional, I dance with so many choreographers from ballet and folklore and modern with everyone I work in Egypt with this choreographer.
And in Egypt, because you kind of separated, at least from how I felt it, that there is a university education, then you can dance You can study dance on the side. Are there universities that actually offer dance degrees of some sort in Egypt? So the person can go and get university education, but right away it's related to dance?
I repeat the question to be sure that I understand. You ask that have university give you certificate for dance? We have academies. It's like university, same level.
But is it considered something like common for people to go and study dance like in academies, or usually people go to universities for like whichever other degree like their family or they
No,
decide?
no. We have like a ballet academy, and when you finish this, you can continue to study with the folklore. But we have academy of ballet. We have academy of theater, like music. It's the same. This is the academy, same level like university.
And for your own training, because you mentioned that in the national school that you studied Egyptian folklore, but also they gave a lot of attention to ballet. Do you consider now that ballet training was really helpful for you? Like how now you see it from years of experience in
No,
dancing?
the ballet is important for any dance. It's the basic for any dance. But I talk about basic ballet, not ballet like a professional dancer in ballet. We study the basic of ballet, the basic that you can be on the stage. You know the rules of the dance. You know how. The posture, the body, how to move, how to be, how you have your balance. Because for me, I think it is the basic for any dance. You should to know the basic of ballet. For me.
That's actually a very interesting topic. Can you tell us a little bit more, in your opinion, what are the basic principles of ballet that every ballet dancer need to learn and try to develop those skills? Like what exactly we can take as ballet dancers from ballet and apply to the stage?
No, for me, for example, to know what is the meaning the stage, the first point. You should to know what is the meaning of the stage. You should to know how you should to because so many movements, it's similar like ballet. For example, we use arabesque, we use stair, we use all turns, we use all this movement. I don't mean we should to dance like ballet. But we should to know how to move to be the to become the quality more better. But also not dance too much ballet. Don't change the style of the dance. For example, ballet, if you make the movement like ballet, it became not ballet dance. But I mean, you should to know the way to do the technique of the movement, but we use this for belly dance, because so many dancers, I saw so many dancers dance like too much ballet. We don't need this also. We need just take the technique to know how you take your energy, your balance for the movement, that we use it from ballet. And I didn't mean the movement like when we use original belly dance, for example, like hip drop, like chimney, like undulation. All this movement, we don't need ballet for this. But when we talk about movement, we use it like when we say some words like chaîne, like pirouette, like arabesque, like fouetté. All this movement, where it's take it from ballet. So we should to know how this technique to make the style is much better. But don't dance like ballet, not too much strong like ballet.
Yeah, that's exactly what I meant, because of course, obviously, belly dance and ballet, it's two different styles. It's not about like mixing or transforming one to another, but
Because so many dancers when use it in not in right way, but when using good way, it became the style, it became very, very nice.
yes, exactly. That's why I sort of decided to clarify, like what exactly are those principles and things that we can naturally borrow, because I think especially for beginner or intermediate belly dancers, it's sometimes confusing. Like we keep hearing like, oh, we need to study ballet because it helps, but what exactly? So that's why I was interested to point in your opinion, what are actually those principles of like turns or balance or maybe body lines that we can borrow?
Just the basic movements that we use it. For example, in my classes, with beginners, with my students, I teach just the movement that we use it in belly dance. Just basic technique, not teach ballet, not teach ballet. It's completely different. Just for example, we use turns. For example, the turn. How you make a turn if you don't know how you take your force, how you turn on 1 foot or two of both? How you know this technique? It have original technique. We should to know how to do it from this and how we dance in belly dance after.
So true. Do you think there is a certain age that people can start incorporating or learning the basics of ballet for ballet dance purpose of you? Or it can be like if someone is doing ballet dance for some certain time and they may be not in that young age that it's typical to start learning ballet, but do you think it's too late for them to start incorporating ballet principles and learning like the basics of ballet?
No. Any dance, we say always when you learn when you're young is it much better. But that we learn is a basic. So it's not hard. We don't need to make a strong movement. We just learn the basic. The basic is very not too much work apart from ballet. So any age can learn this because it's just the basic for some movements. Not all ballet, not all basic of ballet, not all. Just I say about I talk about myself. I teach my students the movements that we use from ballet in ballet dance. Just this moment. This moment don't need just young, only young to learn it. Any age can do it.
Coming back to your activities specifically as a dancer, and I know that you performed and worked at El Balloon Theater in Cairo, which is very important
Yes, yes.
theater. Can you tell us a little bit about that time and also why you decided to leave such an important establishment and start working more with different private groups? Why was this transition in your dance story?
Okay. Look, in life we have career, so you change to take when you make a step, you need to make another step to arrive to your dream. Okay, so when Elkawmeia, when I study in Elkawmeia is the bar, the place of study in the theater, inside the theater El Ballon. Okay, so I learned there inside the El Ballon theater. Okay, I learned with Elkawmeia there. And then I dance in private in the show, also with another choreographer in El Ballon with different choreographers on the stage. Okay, And after this step, I moved to dance with another choreographer in another places, in TV, in cinema, in another theater, in so just steps in to take more experience to arrive about that what you want. For example, for me, I don't want stay all my life in one group. I want always to learn more, take experience more with new choreographer, with new idea, with new places. So it's not not everyone have different idea. I like to change, to have more experience.
Mm-hmm. And how different is dancing in the theater and the because this theater is sort of I guess supervised by government in a like more strict way than like other I guess dance troupes. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong here. So how is it different?
I try to understand.
Yeah, how is it to sort of perform and dance in the sort of government supervised theater in contrast to dancing in private groups?
It's completely different. It's completely different. When you dance in government, in group of government, so this group is for the government, not for the private. Private, the choreographers. For example, when we have shows, the choreographer select best of the best dancers. For example, I have one singer I danced before with in private group like Hassan, Hafifi, like so many groups, and with singer named Samir Sabri. This singer is private, but he select the best dancer from each group. For example, Elkawmeia, Reda, another group, he selects the dancer one by one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, to have this dancer. Government group, you have more rules. You have more rules. You should to be study in the school this group and grow with this group and grow with and grow. Till you arrive in the first line, but in private, take already you are a dancer. He take just when you are ready, when you are already in good line.
By the way, a lot of your training and activities, at least back in Egypt, they were a lot connected to Egyptian folklore dance. But today you also is a teacher of both Egyptian folklore and Oriental. What was the time that Oriental or ballet dance, as we like name it today, what was the time that it entered your dance career?
Okay. When I dance folklore, okay, we have in same. For example, dance one ballet, okay? One Iskandarani, have dance male dancer and female dancer, okay?
Mm-hmm.
The choreographer makes the movement for the male and makes the movement for female.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So, I grow with this. I saw this front of me. So, normally we learn two of both together, okay? And when I transferred from Egypt to Europe, the people interesting to for belly dance, and me also, I like to make a choreograph for belly dance because I in this for music of belly dance, it may make me can. Use all my experience to put it in this choreograph because the music of ballet dance is very rich.
Mm-hmm.
So this is one of my favorite dream that I wanna do, that became choreographer of ballet dance, because I use all my experience, all the styles that I learn when I make choreograph oriental. So I make my tops, my experience, all the experience. But with the folklore also is not easy. With the folklore also is not easy, and enjoy also with this, because you know, folklore, Egyptian folklore, always rich. So two of both, I think two of both is very important for any choreographer. Should to know, do it two of both very well.
That's definitely, I can only add from myself that I attended once your workshop in Saidi topic and another in mezzancene, and I'm not quite sure which one was easier or more difficult. Folklore was very, very challenging, your presentation of it. So that's definitely, folklore is not an easy thing.
Thank you, Maggie. Thank you.
When you moved to Europe, did you right away wanted to pursue a dance career, or was it something that just naturally happened?
No, I moved from 16 years ago. It was my dream to start to travel, to take my idea, I want to show the people around the world that what I can do it. So if I stay in Egypt, you can't know me just if you come in Egypt. Okay, so I start to thinking that I want to go for the people, to, because 16 years ago, it's not like now.
Yes.
Time is changing. In that time, it was more difficult. Not like now with social media, with Instagram, Facebook. Not like now. It was more difficult.
Do you think right now you could have reached your dreams and goals without moving outside of Egypt, like with all the social media tools? How do you think?
I don't know but for me I prefer the old style all the time, because now anyone can write anything, anyone can say anything, and the people don't know who is right. Before, the students traveling, go to study, more interesting. Now, it's too much. On internet, it's too much. Now it's too much on internet. It's too much. The student is tired, because it makes confused for the students. Each one now wants, for example, want to start to teach or perform this year, won't start from the point that another dancer danced, for example, before 10 years. Won't start from this point, from this point. Don't want make experience. I say always for my students, you should to make your experience. The experience come with the timing. So take your time. Take your time to have your experience. Mm-hmm. Not everything became very fast. Internet now make everything became very fast.
Oh, seems to be very fast.
Anyone now can advertising herself or himself is very, very fast. And the people, for example, when see this, after it's finished, because not good experience. So I think now everything is very fast, and make a student also tired, the audience tired from this.
Yeah, like also the quick start means very often a quick finish too. Except of dancing and teaching career, you are also involved into producing music. And I think one of the most famous songs that were produced under your direction is probably Mazagat, along with many other songs. Can you take us a little bit more inside this process? How, in general, like the music creation and music production from under direction of the dancer, how does it look? Like, what's the processes even like?
Okay. The music, it's, when we dance with the music, right? So when you have idea for the dance, we make it, we start from the music, because we need to have the music to make the idea of the movement that you want to make a choreograph. So when I want to make music, I have I first I have the idea, and after I go for the composer. I think I talk to him. I want this one. I want this part to start like this, with this instrument, with this rhythm, with this melody. And after we go with this part, and I give him all my idea, and he start to work. And I listen with him. I say, no, I don't want this. We change it. We change it till we arrive the version that I want. Okay, we start to make now. We start to make this real. So with the musician, we go in studio and take every instrument, all basic of drum or. And after, when we finish this, we make a master. So it's very hard work, but interesting, because I love it this. And with this point also of the music, like a dance, like everything, now everything, it's a copy. It became very fast. All copy now, all copy. No, for example, you make a lot of idea. You thinking about what you want to make it, and became another one, copy what you do it. So it became very, very easy now. But I continue to make the music every year. I make one album. I have now like around, I start from 2008, I think, first album. I think, I don't remember exactly, but I think in this date, I don't remember exactly, but every year I make a new album.
And do you work with musicians from Egypt, or you find someone in Europe now to record your music?
No. All in Egypt. All in Egypt. But I changed the composer, the musician, to have different quality. When I have different quality, make give you dance in different way. So I change it always, but all from Egypt.
Do you have yourself a music education, or you are more relying on your dancer's intuition that you need to com when you need to communicate something to musicians?
No, we learn the music with experience, with the dance, because we grow up dance with the musician. So we know, I know so many things from the music. I'm not study in like I'm study dancing. But I know I can communicate it with them. I know how communicate it with them.
It's very interesting because dancers and musicians' communication, sometimes it gets funny. I mean, I never had experience of recording CD, but even on stage before performance, when we communicate, sometimes we feel that we are talking in different languages. So I can only imagine if we are talking about actual recording and producing music, it can go sometimes very, very challenging. When you were doing
Yeah, because we grow up with this, we work together, we work with the musician so many years in Egypt. So I know how them talking. I know if I want something, I know what is the name of this of what I want. I can explain for them. I don't need to suffer to explain them what I want. Because we have the words, we understand each other, so it's very easy for us.
I also know that there is sometimes an issue of copyrights with music. I'm not much familiar with this topic, but I just heard, like, I kind of have an idea that because a lot of many times those CDs, they have a sort of different versions of other famous songs, but in their own interpretation, like songs from Kalsum, or like those like old songs from different composers. How that works? Like, I'm just really curious because it's the whole different world that we as dancers, we just hear the final product and listen to the
Okay,
and to dance.
some songs is old songs, but I make remixes. Some songs and another music, I make it new. It's new. It's all words and melody is all new. It's make it just for me. And some songs is old me is old songs, like for example song of Kulthum, Abdul Halim Hafiz, Farid Al Atrash. This is very rich music, and we make it remix, and this for everyone can make this, not only me. But when is all the music, anyone can make remix, it's not me. But for example, when it's one music, it's my created for me, it's for me.
I believe, I'm not sure, but I heard somewhere that if the song is older than 60 years or something like 70 or 80, I don't know the number exactly, but it's sort of like that. It's sort of like the public domain that you can make remixes, but if it's a new ones, so if it's a new one, it's basically you can't even do remix without asking actually permission from the authors.
No, no, no. When I make it remix, I use all the music. All the music.
That's very interesting because it's a completely like that kind of world. It usually stays behind the scene, and as dancers, we don't realize how much work and how much energy and attention should be put in the
Yes,
production of one CD.
of course.
So thanks for sharing little insights. By the way, are your CDs available somewhere online for people to purchase?
No, I didn't sell online. I'm still with old fashion, not commercial. But I thinking to put it in online because so many people ask me why you didn't put online, why didn't, so I thinking to put it online.
But for now, until they are online, what is the best way to purchase them?
As anyone write me, I send with for home address.
I think that's the way that I got one of your CDs too. But hopefully soon you'll put them online, and because it will be, I'm sure, like more people will even discover about them on through iTunes or Spotify.
I try. I will try soon to do this.
Yeah, because the music is really beautiful, and some songs they became really
Ah, thanks.
famous, but I feel there are many songs from your CDs that are less famous, but just because people don't get to hear them because they are really beautiful and they need more showcase. For sure.
Thank you, my dear. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Also, you, on top of everything, you are also an event organizer and you host your festival.
I have Heshik Beshik. I'm the guest. Heshik Beshik, I stopped last 2-3 years because I went back with new ideas because, you know, like we talked before, everyone copy what you do it. So I will back with Heshik Beshik again. Two different festivals. Heshik Beshik in Venice and Mazagat in Bari.
Which one is coming up sooner?
And now I didn't decide because I just finished Mazagat in December. So I didn't decide yet the date of Mazagat. And I think Heshik Beshik will back again summer of next year, but now I am busy for my new event in Cairo, Joel of the Nile, organized by myself and with Mr. Yusuf Shreef. We organized this new event in Cairo, so many things to do it. And soon I will, all the information will be available online.
Oh, so we are about to hear about the third festival of yours. That's great. Cairo. Can you tell approximately at least so people can mark their calendars? I mean, is it going to be summer, winter, or half a year from now?
So... No, summer. 2020.
Oh, okay, so that people can plan in advance.
Yeah. And I have another event in Egypt, in Turin, in October also, in Italy. Schedule is so busy.
Ah, I see. Very like spread geographically also, all events, and great opportunity for different people to visit also different countries and not only enjoy Egyptian culture while visiting your festival, but also explore Italy too and study more even with you. But this is quite crazy. I kind of feel like organizing four basically events, or three upcoming, like the third one is upcoming soon, new one. How big is your team to help you to put together all those kind of like events together? Because as a solo, as just one organizer, it's nearly impossible, I believe.
No, my team is each event have a different team.
Mm-hmm.
Not all events in only one team. Each event have different team.
Well, looking forward to hearing more information about your new upcoming event in Egypt. It's sounds very exciting, like something new and different from you, different from other.
It will be very strong event. It's all new idea, new form, new style. Will be completely different than usually we see all festivals around the world.
Mm. Well, very intrigued already. I wish you good luck with your upcoming events and all your dance workshops and festivals and trips all around the world that you have. So thank you also for finding time to have this interview and really we covered today so interesting topics that not often we get to talk about and see a glimpse in the work in progress. So thank you so much for sharing your experience and your story.
Thank you for you, dear. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. It was my pleasure always.
And I always sum up every interview with our traditional question of this podcast. And the question is, what makes you fall in love with ballet dance again and again? Or in this case, I would say Egyptian folklore and Oriental. What makes you fall in love again and again? So you keep doing it as your profession for so many years.
Me, I love to perform folklore. For love for folklore to perform, but I love also Oriental. It's two of both. It's very, I'm full in love for two of both.
Do you know why? Have you ever asked yourself why you really love these dances?
No, because no answer is the art, or you love or you not love. You don't love. It's without answer. Are you love or not?
Thank you for listening, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this episode. And if so, do you know the best way to support this project is to share it with your friends. It takes a few seconds, costs you nothing, but it helps a lot to move this project forward and help me to bring more awesome guests on the podcast in the future. You can tell your friend, you can send a message, email, you can screenshot and put a post on social media, whatever works better for you. But if every one of you will share this episode at least with one more person, it will make a huge difference for this podcast. Thank you for spending your time with us, for your support and love. And until next time, keep shimmying, keep dancing, and I will see you soon.